I've just finished writing a book about the history of girls' grammar. It's a draft form now. But one of the things I found when I was writing that history is how much unlearning had to happen in that school. I think, for example, I was looking at activities like the high jump. Now, in the high jump, there's a picture of a girl, Thelma Nagel, in 1920. She's high jumping, and it's really bizarre. She's got her both feet up, tucked up under her body, with her knees bent, and she's sort of jumping over the high jump. Her knees are together, and her feet are together, and they're all just tucked up under her body. So it's like a little jump that she's doing over the high jump. Well, it wouldn't have been a little jump because she was a champion high jumper. But in 1920, that's the way girls jump high jump. For a start, you couldn't put your knees apart. That wasn't on. But it was generally, that was how they did it. Now, what happened with the high jump? High jump's a classic example of unlearning, because there's no way in the world that Thelma Nagel could keep practicing and getting better and better at that technique once the straddle technique turns up. Because once the straddle technique arrives, then she's not, her medium height's against her, and so is that, there's no way in the world she can do that. So she's going to have to start again on something else, or at least unlearn that strange little dainty jumping. And of course, what happened with high jump is people who got good at straddle, then we get the Western roll. And Western roll, then you turn the body to the bar, and people are going higher in the Western roll. So people who did straddle, or scissors, if you like, at that point, scissors, is not as good as Western roll. And then Eastern roll turns up, and so people then try to adapt to Eastern roll. And then, of course, in the 1960s, the Fosbury flop, which is what is done today, blows everybody away. Now, so people who got really, really good at Western roll had to unlearn Western roll or else get out of high jump. That's the point about the constant problem of unlearning. So if you say, I'm going to keep doing Western roll because I'm good at it, well, you're not going to be a champion high jumper. That's what you're not going to be doing, because now people are doing this. I also found interesting that actually coaches were saying that straddle, you can actually get as high with straddle as the Fosbury flop, but straddle is harder to teach and harder to master. So most people just simply do the Fosbury flop, and it's now become the thing until they find the next thing, in which case the champion athletes of the day have to unlearn and relearn. So I think it's quite interesting about what that involves. And of course, it's also interesting about what sort of teaching is involved with that too. And that's where we have to keep thinking about being usefully ignorant. Doesn't mean we don't teach the technique of writing a good essay, but we also have to show that that's not necessarily good writing in all contexts. And we have to think about what that would mean. Again, we're thinking about our young people not knowing everything, but being good editors and assemblers of value-added work, cultural products and so on that make for really very good products, but also for good thinking. The combination of aesthetic and function that Dan Pink talks about, where we start to try to encourage young people to build that capacity. And it's not about us saying, we know things, we tell you, we give you a worksheet, you work your way through, and then you give it back to us. So for us, if we're going to unlearn, we have to then think about unlearning the sort of things that teachers, I guess, do that we've thought we needed to do to be effective teachers. So if we're going to think about the equivalent of the high jump, as a high jump coach, you actually would have to unlearn. You could not just stay with it. I guess you could and decide that none of your students were going to be able to do the next iteration. But we have to push on from there. So what do I need to unlearn about teaching in order to engage students in meaningful learning? And I've made this point before. This changes what we do. Sage on the stage, guide on the side, meddler in the middle. Now, there are times to be a sage on the stage. There are times to do that. Clear instruction, good thing. Times to be a guide on the side, get right out of the way. There are times, I guess, to pull right off and let the kids have a go. But I've been increasingly critical of guide on the side because I think it has allowed people to become comfortable and to do consoling pedagogy And I think when it collapses into consoling pedagogy, then the challenge disappears. And then our promises to kids that, you know, that they'll leave our school as lifelong learners or challenged or whatever else, become hollow promises.